Give us a light, mate.
You can't smoke in here.
Yes, I can. Watch. Well, you know, after the American tour, which ended in March 2002, we sort of came back to England and wrote some new songs. But, you know, frankly, we were cream crackered, yeah? Knackered. Yeah. We played our last date together as a band at the Isle of MTV show in Portugal around, when was it? It was June 2002. And that was it. And after that, we just concentrated on trying to make this sort of turdy Gorillaz film.
Yeah, well, we got so many offers to make a film in America. At a time, it seemed like a waste not to take the opportunity.
So we all moved over to LA for a while, you know, La La Land, and we sort of hired this big house out in the sort of kind of like a Hollywood thing, you know, it's like up in the hills, you know, so that we could sort of, you know, sort of be right in the hub, you know what I'm saying, in the hub of where we were sort of meant to be filming. But I've got to say, you know, man, there was a lot of great distractions, you know what I mean?
And the film negotiations were just endless.
Oh, man, I was just, like, really, really tedious, yeah?
Yeah, we got caught up in rehearsals, meetings, script approvals.
The script was unfinished. The people writing it thought they were making a very insightful yet ironic comment on popular culture, a supposedly non-linear Charlie Kaufman-esque animation in which the four main protagonists, namely Gorillaz, fall randomly in and out of a number of surreal situations. But in fact, the scriptwriters were just like, making it up as they went along.
Will you wake us up when you finish, Noodle?
I guess what she's trying to say is they thought it was going to be like a modern version of the Monkees movie Head?
Yeah. Thing is, the person they chose to play me looked like some old wrinkly geriatric, you know? It's really insulting. You know, and he smelt, you know? What a pen and ink, you know? I think it might have been Robert Downey Sr. I mean, that guy must have been pushing 70, you know?
Have you looked in the mirror recently?
Listen, mate. I may be no spring chicken, but I don't look that rough, do I? I mean, the wrinkles on my face are all laughter lines.
Nothing's that funny. Anyhow, the situation went downhill from there. No one was focused enough. 2D couldn't understand the difference between film and reality. Murdoch got himself kicked out of the Playboy mansions for stealing ashtrays.
And Russell got a big fat ego and then changed his name to R. Diddy.
So eventually we decided to cut our losses and take time off to recuperate.
This just lead to further misadventure.
So, you know, man, you know, when we realized we were just sort of whistling in the wind, we decided to have a break from each other. So I headed down south to try my luck in Mexico. Yeah. But yeah, there was some sort of mix-up, you know, my finances, and I kind of got accused of...
Yeah. He was found using counterfeit checks in a Mexican brothel.
The Chicken Choker. Wonderful place and fantastic staff. Yeah. Happy days.
Basically, he got caught passing dud checks off as payment to the girls. And consequently, Murdoch got taken to jail.
Yeah, all right, Russell. Russell spent a long time trying to recuperate. He ended up living in Ike Turner's basement. Ike Turner! You went a wee bit mental, didn't you, Russell?
Well, he certainly looked a lot like Ike Turner. I was working on an album of my own, but eventually it felt like the album was working on me. It was a strange time. When you work in a band with people for such a long period, and then that suddenly stops, it can leave you at a loss. I think I had some kind of breakdown. I just lost one of my closest friends, Dale, the spirit who used to live inside me, and the strain was starting to show. Every song I tried to record would become a hallucination. Then the hallucination would try to write the song, which would then get up and become another...
Russell, man. It's probably... No.
I'm sorry.
No, it's man. It's all right.
I'm sorry.
Take it easy, man. Have a salad, you know. Okay. It's probably best, you know, not to dig too deep on this one.
Yeah.
dark place, man, dark place. Mm. So, anyway, after 18 months in this sort of Tijuana jail, I thought, enough is enough. And with a little help from my friends, I got myself sort of out and back home to Blighty, the good old U of the K. But I tell you, that's enough South America for me for a while. You know, the prison food, yeah, it's rubbish. I don't think I could eat another burrito in my life.
Yeah, but you still like a bit of Mexican sausage, eh, man?
Shut up, you little fuck. So, by the time I got back, Noodle had also returned from her trip to her Japanese homeland and was already in the process of recording a new album, or, you know, at least laying down a lot of the groundwork.
Yes, I had been to Japan for about a year, researching my past, as it had always been a mystery to me. It was during this period that I was awoken from my extended amnesia, and in doing so, I discovered many interesting facts about myself, one of which is that I knew English language fluently. Having been revitalized, I returned to England and I began to lay foundation for a new Gorillaz album. However, Kong Studios, where we live and record, had been lying dormant and empty during our absence.
Oh, yeah, you know, it's hard to get good staff to clean a haunted studio.
Yes, no one had maintained the building and it had also been broken into. There seemed to be a plague of the walking undead infesting the building. Corpses lined the corridors.
So once we were back, you know, it took a little while to get into the swing of things. I mean, it can be very distracting when you got 6 or 7 decomposing zombies stuck up your chimney flue, you know.
We got chimney flue?
I'm speaking metaphorically, Dee. I'm using the analogy of a chimney flue to describe the passageways of our flowing creativity. The zombies in this case are used as a metaphor, as in blockages to the airways, figuratively speaking.
Really?
No. There really are about 6 or 7 undead carcasses stuck up the studio chimney.
That explained the smell, wouldn't it, yeah. I stayed round in Los Angeles for a while. I got invited to stay round Brick Eklund's flat. But, you know, she's nuts. Running around naked, banging on the walls half the night. I never got any sleep. So I nodded off back to my dad's place on the coast of England. I got a temporary job, like, working on the rides at my old man's, like, funfair. Which was wicked, really. It did a lot for my confidence, yeah? I put up with a lot less crap than that geriatric mad dot now.
Oi, you! Pass us the ashtray, now!
Yeah, certainly, sir, you go.
I originally discovered the building, which now houses Kong Studios, back in 1999. I was looking for a cheap studio space on the internet, and it threw up this little gem. It's located on a hilltop in Essex, and believe me, there aren't many hills in Essex. There's one in Langdon, I think. But it wasn't until we'd sort of been there for a year or so that we discovered the truth about the place.
Oh, horrible.
It turns out the original site for the building was like a druid's meeting point. It was picked specially for its unique alignment of dark energies and hideous ley lines. The first Kong building was erected on top of an old disused cemetery. A lot of people who died in the Great Plague of 1665 were dumped there in shallow graves and burial pits.
Poor people.
Yeah. Poor people. The current building here, where our studios are, is situated next to one of the biggest landfill sites in the country. So it's like sort of, you know, it's full of old fridges, nappies, colostomy bags, rotten cows, you know, all sorts. You know. Just, you know, just barely buried, you know. And in the middle of the summer, you know, when it gets hot, the stench is unbelievable. It, I don't know, it's like someone cooking turds or something.
So, and no one seems to sell efficient air freshener in Essex.
No. I mean, the last owners were this kind of biker gang, you know, these cats who use the building as their clubhouse. You know. They're called the Nomads. But they'd chosen to settle there for some reason. Anyway, one night they all got caught in a fire in the building, yeah. Burnt to a crisp. Which no one told us about when we bought the place.
Man, that place is full of bad spirits and sick vibrations.
Still, you know, we gave it a lick of paint and hung up a couple of posters. It looks great. It's got...
Yes, the website gorillaz.com allows our online fans to roam around the Kong Studios building. As the place acts as a home, our studios and the Gorillaz HQ, there's a lot for people to see and do. There are interactive cameras in every room and corridor of the building, allowing people to see right into their lives. They can use the instruments in the studio room or talk to the characters that hang out there.
There's various places they can go.
It's also the place where the fans can interact with each other on the message boards, and now we got our own auditions room where people can send in their tapes and animations and work. Noodle's currently running a competition to find new talent, maybe someone to work with the Gorillaz in some way.
We've had some fantastic entries, and there's like 3 or 4 floors to the building now, right? And you can like take a look around our bedrooms, yeah.
Why would anyone want to look around your bedroom?
Basically, we spent a lot of money extending the place, building more and more parts onto it. It's been broken into a couple of times whilst we've been away. Some vandals sprayed a lot of anti-murder graffiti on the walls.
Things like Murdoch is a twat, and things like Murdoch is a
you
twat.
You mongrel! Still in the mood, aren't you? Because Busted split up.
Also, the producer we've been working with, Danger Mouse, found a whole underground section of the place that had been blocked off for years. Pretty creepy.
I'm really parched, you know? I'm spitting feathers. Is there anybody who could get me a beer around here? Anywhere at all you can get one of those things. Noodle started working on the initial sketches of the album while we were all still kind of preoccupied, you know. Lucky for her, I'd left a very specific set of instructions as to how the new song should, you know, sound.
That was just a tape of you humming.
Gotcha.
Actually, Noodle wrote most of the album herself. Murdoch may try to take the credit for it, but from the basic sketches to the finished album, this was Noodle's vision.
Hi. So, I started writing near the beginning of the year, around March of 2004. I began just writing basic tunes on my Tascam 4 track, sketching out ideas as I proceeded. Once I had what I felt to be the main outline and template for the album, I started laying further textures, melodies and sounds over the top. The compositions began to take shape, and gradually, the songs began revealing their true identities and to which direction they needed to be taken. But at this stage, they lacked that certain life and still required that a spark of electricity that transforms a great song into something that has a magical life of its own.
Well, you know, I would have helped her out, but as I said, I was still in jail at this time, you know.
And yes, and it was around then that I heard of DJ Danger Mouse. I was impressed with the work he had done on his own Grey album, which I had done loaded from the internet. On the Grey album, he had spliced together the work of the Beatles and Jay-Z to create something new. It was wonderfully inventive and showed a childlike creativity, artistic bravery and disregard for convention that I thought suited Gorillaz. So I contacted him.
Then what happened?
Well, it took a while to convince him to work with Gorillaz.
Yeah, I think he was at ease relaxing on his new island, just kind of burning through all the cash he made off the Grey album sales.
Well, he wasn't overly keen on leaving sunny LA to go and work in a rundown, haunted studio in rain-sodden Essex. Mm. Although, I can't think why.
Me neither.
But, Gorillaz have ways of making you work.
Shh.
The album took a leap into the incredible when the producer Danger Mouse finally arrived. This would be around June 2004. Mr. Mouse and myself immediately began an intricate pre-production session.
Yeah, this mainly involved sort of playing table tennis and listening to a load of old electro records. He's an odd-looking fellow, you know. He Ginger Mouse. He's got like this, you know, sort of like a huge hair, you know. No, I mean really, really big hair. He looks a little bit like that David Blaine cat, with the wig, like he's got a wig on. You know?
No. Yes, so the recording session became more intense, and the more we proceeded, the more in synchronization we became. Danger Mouse is a very instinctive and insightful producer. He looks to find the relevance or sort of a song. Once he had located a particular voice of a track, he will then make it talk to the other compositions around it. This way the album works as a complete article. As the full understanding of what we were making became apparent, we began to draft in various collaborators to add certain souls to the relevant tracks. Each artist would have to complete the expedition all the way to the summit of Kong Studios in order to record.
Although some of the latest submissions have been delivered via digital phone lines from around the globe.
So, I finally got back around October, then, what's his name, 2D turned up.
Hello?
Then Big Russell got back from his little mental vacation late last November.
Noodle and Danger Mouse basically called us in to do our parts, for 2D to do his vocals, Murdoch to redo some bass lines, and any other collaborators were called in as and when we needed them. But apart from that, they've been highly secretive about the whole recording. They didn't even let other gorillas really hear it.
Yeah, didn't want to.
Finally, when we knew we had what we needed, we all fled the confines of Kong and set up camp over at the PS Rooms in West London. It was here that we added the last of the overdubs and worked on the final mixdown.
Oh, I'm bored of all this. Oh, anyone fancy a quick
Shut up, man.
Don't have a cow, man.
And it was during this period that we isolated the songs which, although were standout tracks musically, didn't fit in with the overall sensibility of the album. They were then removed, yes, and there was a songs that seemed maybe part of a different dialogue and would have interrupted the arc of the album's narrative. It had to be focused and efficient, a consistent thought. Yes.
You see, it's all in the edit. The album was then mastered over in New York, January 2005, and that was it, completed.
Yeah. Well, so it came out pretty well like I told her to make it in the first place.